Daniel chapter 9, the three divisions of the 70 weeks, we're coming to verses 25 to 27, where the prophecy gets extremely interesting, so pay close attention, and I'm going to read the whole chapter. In the first year of Darius, the son of Ahasuerus, the seed of the Medes, which was made king over the realm of the Chaldeans, in the first year of his reign, I, Daniel, understood by books the number of the years whereof the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah the prophet, that he would accomplish 70 years in the desolations of Jerusalem. And I set my face unto the Lord God to seek by prayer and supplication with fasting and sackcloth and ashes. And I prayed unto the Lord my God and made my confession and said, O Lord, the great and dreadful God, keeping the covenant and mercy to them that love him and to them that keep his commandments. We have sinned and have committed iniquity and have done wickedly and have rebelled, even by departing from thy precepts and thy judgments. Neither have we hearkened unto thy servants the prophets, which spake in thy name to our kings, our princes, and our fathers, and to all the people of the land. O Lord, righteous belongeth unto thee, but unto us confusion of faces as it is this day. To the men of Judah, and to the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and unto all Israel, that are near and that are afar off, through all the countries whither thou hast driven them, because of their trespass, that they have trespassed against thee. O Lord, to us belongeth confusion of face, to our kings, to our princes, and to our fathers, because we have sinned against thee. To the Lord our God belongeth mercies and forgivenesses, though we have rebelled against him. Neither have we obeyed the voice of the Lord thy God to walk in his laws, which he set before us by his servants the prophets. Yea, all Israel have transgressed thy law, even by departing, that they may not obey thy voice. Therefore the curse is poured upon us, and the oath that is written in the law of Moses the servant of God, because we have sinned against him, and have confirmed his words, which he spake against us, and against our judges that judged us, by bringing upon us a great evil. For unto the whole heaven hath not been done as hath been done upon Jerusalem. As it is written in the law of Moses, all this evil has come upon us. Yet made we not our prayer before the Lord our God, that we might turn from our iniquities and understand thy truth. Therefore hath the Lord watched upon the evil and brought it upon us. For the Lord our God is righteous in all his works which he doeth, for we obeyed not his voice. And now, O Lord our God, that hath brought thy people forth from the land of Egypt with a mighty hand, and hast gotten thee renowned, as it is this day we have sinned, we have done wickedly. O Lord, according to all thy righteousness, I beseech thee, let thine anger and thy fury be turned away from thy city, Jerusalem, thy holy mountain, because of our sins and for the iniquities of our fathers. Jerusalem and thy people are become a reproach to all that are about us. Now therefore, our Lord God, hear the prayer of thy servant and his supplications, and cause thy face to shine upon thy sanctuary that is desolate for the Lord's sake. O my God, incline thine ear and hear. Open thine eyes and behold our desolations and the city which is called by thy name. For we do not present our supplications before thee for our righteousness, but for thy great mercies. O Lord, hear. O Lord, forgive. O Lord, hearken and do. Defer not for thine own sake, O my God, for thy city and thy people are called by thy name. And whilst I was speaking and praying and confessing my sin and the sin of the people of Israel, and presenting my supplication before the Lord my God for the holy mountain of my God, yea, whilst I was speaking in prayer, even the man Gabriel, whom I had seen in the vision at the beginning, being caused to fly swiftly, touched me about the time of the evening oblation. And he informed me and talked with me and said, O Daniel, I am now come forth to give thee skill and understanding. At the beginning of thy supplications, the commandment came forth, and I came to show thee, for thou art greatly beloved. Therefore understand the matter and consider the vision. 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon the holy city to finish the transgressions and to make an end of sins and to make reconciliation for iniquity and to bring in everlasting righteousness and to seal up the vision and prophecy and to anoint the most holy. And here's the last three verses, which are a text this morning and this afternoon. Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem unto the Messiah, the Prince, shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. The street shall be built again and the wall, even in troublous times. And after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself. And the people of the prince that shall come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary, and the end thereof shall be with a flood. And unto the end of the war of desolations are determined. And he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. And in the midst of the week he shall cause the sacrifice and oblation to cease. And for the overspreading of abominations, literally the little wing of abominations, he shall make it desolate, even unto the consummation that is determined shall be poured upon the desolate. Amazing section of scripture, and we'll look at it carefully. The prophecy that begins in verse 24 and sets forth six things, and we looked at this last week, that the Messiah accomplishes within 490 years, continues with details designed to give us a clear understanding of this period. Remember, this is an amazing section of Scripture. It tells us when the Messiah is going to come. Well, it tells us when Jerusalem and the temple is going to be rebuilt. It tells us when the Messiah is going to come. It tells us what the Messiah is going to do. And it tells us the consequences of the Messiah, his coming. It's an amazing passage. Therefore, Gabriel tells Daniel, know and understand. This is similar to Jesus' statement in Matthew 15:10, hear and understand. Or Matthew's comment in Matthew 24:15, whoever reads, let him understand. Prophecy is given to be understood and comprehended. And as we'll see today, this is not a difficult passage. I know people have twisted it, but it's not a difficult passage. Gabriel knows that the message he is delivering is difficult to Daniel. Now, we have further revelation. For us, it's not near as difficult and requires a spiritual mind and careful analysis. This comment is an implicit rebuke to those schools of thought which manipulate prophecy into a system and give interpretations unknown to the Church of Christ into the latter half of the 1800s. And we discussed this last week, how we have a great prophecy of the Messiah in verse 27, which they turn into the Antichrist, which is insanity. There are a number of things in this passage that we need to understand. First, when does the 490 years begin? Or when does the going forth of the command to restore and build Jerusalem begin? Well, the Orthodox view, which is the only view which makes any sense at all and comports with Scripture, is that the period begins with the decree of Cyrus, which was the great edict of liberation for the Jews. And this occurs in the year 538 or 537 BC, in which the exile came to an end and a new order of things appeared. Thus in Daniel 1:21, we are told that Daniel, the great statesman of the Babylonian court, the court of that nation which oppressed Israel, continued until the first year of Cyrus. So there's all these hints that tell us. And this view is proved by the fact that 483 years separates the going forth of the commandment and the manifestation of Messiah the Prince. And I didn't go into detail about dates, but some of the books I have go into great, great detail showing that the 483 years ends perfectly with the baptism of Jesus. The divinely prompted decree of Cyrus is noted in 2 Chronicles 26, 22 to 23. Excuse me, 36. 2 Chronicles 36, 22 to 23. Now, in the first year of Cyrus, the king of Persia, that the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah might be fulfilled, the Lord stirred up the spirit of Cyrus, king of Persia, so that he made a proclamation throughout all his kingdom and also put it in writing, saying, thus says Cyrus, king of Persia, all the kingdoms of the earth the Lord God of heaven has given me, and he has commanded me to build him a house at Jerusalem, which is in Judah. Who is among you of all his people? May the Lord his God be with him, and let him go up. And then we have this identical decree repeated in Ezra 1:1-4 with a little bit extra details there. All of this was prophesied in Isaiah 44, where God says, I am the Lord who says to Jerusalem, you shall be inhabited, to the cities of Judah you shall be built, who says of Cyrus. Now keep in mind, this is before Cyrus is reigning. He is my shepherd, and he shall perform all my pleasure, saying to Jerusalem, you shall be built, and to the temple your foundation shall be laid. That's verses 24, 26, and 28. The proof that King Cyrus was the one who should give the commandment for the restoring and rebuilding of Jerusalem is doubly foretold, doubly forceful and impressive. And designedly so, as the scripture itself declares, because it was spoken by the mouth of the Lord 200 years before Cyrus came to the throne. And it's these very exacting, very detailed prophecies that have been fulfilled perfectly that are so amazing and so inexplicable to people who are unbelievers and modernists and liberals that they have to explain it away and say, well, it was written after it happened. Well, no, it wasn't written after it happened. It was prophesied 200 years before. Cyrus is again noted specifically as the builder of Jerusalem in Isaiah 45:13. He shall build my city and let my exiles go free. The Bible clearly teaches that the decree begins with Cyrus and involves the restoration and rebuilding of Jerusalem. The 49-year period was literally fulfilled from Cyrus' decree to the end of Nehemiah. The prophecies about the rebuilding of Jerusalem were fulfilled during this period in answer to Daniel's great prayer and the prayers of the saints throughout their captivity. So yes, God answered Daniel's prayer. But as we'll see, God's going to go way beyond that and give Daniel information that goes way beyond what he asked. In a sense, it's what he asked, but I'm sure it's more than he expected. That the rebuilding of the city and temple was accompanied with much outside pressure, which is prophesied, was also clearly fulfilled, and you can read about that in Nehemiah 4:1 and following, 6:1 and following, and 9:36 and 37. And you heard how they were rebuilding the walls, and they had sword and trowel. They had to have swords on them, battle swords, just in case they were attacked as they were rebuilding. And this is a fact of history acknowledged by the ancient Jews and even unbelievers. Here's what Philip Morrow says. Quote, it is interesting in this connection to see how this matter was understood by learned Jews in ancient times. Thus we find recorded in the history of Josephus that Cyrus wrote throughout all his dominions that, quote, God Almighty hath appointed me to be king of the habitable earth, and that he indeed foretold my name by the prophets, and that I should build him a house at Jerusalem, which is in the country of Judea. Okay, those are Cyrus' own words. Josephus goes on to say that when Cyrus had read the words of the prophet Isaiah, quote, he called for the most eminent Jews in Babylon and said to them that he gave them leave to go back to their city, to their country, and to rebuild their city Jerusalem and the temple of God. Josephus also gives a copy of a letter written by Cyrus to the governors that were in Syria, which letter begins as follows. King Cyrus, to Sassanes and Sathrabuzanes, greetings. I have given leave to as many Jews that dwell in my country as please to do so, to return to their own country, and to rebuild their city, and to rebuild the temple of God at Jerusalem on the same place where it was before. Antiquities, book 11, chapter 1. From sections 1 and 3. The proof that the rebuilding of the city was done by the commandment of Cyrus is so conclusive that Prideaux, one of the leading commentators on Daniel, frankly admits that, quote, Jerusalem was rebuilt by virtue of the decree granted by Cyrus in the first year of his reign. Now, he's a liberal. Yet this learned man rejects the decree of Cyrus as the starting point of the 70 weeks simply because he shared the mistaken idea, for which there is no good proof of any sort, that 490 years would not reach from that decree to the days of Christ. But if the fact be, as Purdue admits, then to take any other event as a starting point is to falsify the prophecy. It is a choice between the clear statements of the Word of God and the guesses of heathen historians and astronomers. We are writing for the benefit of those who accept the Word of God as conclusive. End of quote. So I think the scripture is very clear, and I warn you not to listen to the nonsense of modernists who twist and twist, and they go out of their way to try to prove everything doesn't point to Christ, when everything does point to Christ, and everything climaxes with the Messiah, but they don't like that, because they're unbelievers. Well, let's look after the 60 and 2/7. After the setting forth, the 7/7 and the rebuilding of the city, Gabriel turns his attention to the distinguishing characteristics of the 62 sevens. And this is verses 25b and 26. until Messiah the Prince, there shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. And after the 62 weeks, Messiah shall be cut off. But not for himself. And the people of the Prince who is to come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. The end of it shall be with a flood. Until the end of the war, desolations are determined. And then I'll show you in a moment, there's what the Jews use called an ABAB structure. Rather than 27 introducing something new and unique in the distant future, it's repeating what occurs in verse 26 from a different perspective. It's the Jewish way of writing things. The 62 sevens are the period between the building of Jerusalem and the cutting off of the anointed one. After the 62 sevens, two crucial events are to occur. One, the Messiah will be cut off or killed. And two, Jerusalem will be completely destroyed. Now, what we're going to see in a moment, Jesus is cut off in the midst of the last week. Jerusalem is destroyed after the 70 weeks. There's no problem there whatsoever. In verse 27, we learn that the killing of the anointed one occurs in the middle of the 70th week. The destruction of Jerusalem will take place after the 70 weeks expire and are a consequence of the cutting off of the Messiah. And there are a number of important things in these verses that merit careful attention. These are amazing verses. If you don't believe the Bibles are the Word of God, it's because you're spiritually blind and you're a fool. Because the Bible proves itself to be the Word of God so many times and in so many ways, so clearly and so abundantly, there's no reason not to have faith in Christ. First, the one who comes is identified as an anointed one, the Hebrew. Messiah. An anointed one originally was not a technical term for the Messiah in that priests were anointed, Leviticus 4:3-5, as well as kings. There are no examples of prophets being anointed except for Elijah, who was told to anoint Elisha, although the anointing is not recorded. The Davidic kings were called the Lord's anointed. And we know the high priest, they poured olive oil down his head. Now, given the time indicator here, and the judgment that falls as a consequence of the cutting off of the anointed one, the common Christian interpretation that this is a prophecy of Jesus the Messiah is no doubt correct. It's not referring to Antiochus Epiphanes. The prophecy does not fit. He alone satisfies the requirement of this prophecy. Now, Jesus is called the anointed one of the Messiah because he was anointed by the Holy Spirit beyond measure at his baptism in the Jordan by John. The Holy Spirit descends in the form of a dove. Now, you say, well, he's God. Why does he need to be anointed beyond measure? Jesus, according to his human nature, was anointed beyond measure to do the works, and the divine person in Christ deliberately restricted the use of his power. And I'm not going to go into detail all this, the Christology here, but Jesus in his human nature was anointed beyond measure by the Holy Spirit to do the work of ministry. The Holy Spirit descended upon him in the form of a dove, as Peter says in Acts 10:38. God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. Our Lord was aware of this and made it very clear in his first recorded teaching after his baptism. This is from Luke. This is the first thing we have Jesus teaching in the Gospel of Luke. Listen to what he says. He goes into the synagogue, as was his custom. And he was handed the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he had opened the book, he found the place where it is written. So he's handed a scroll. He opens it to this place. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. Then he closed the book And he gave it back to the attendant and sat down. And the eyes of all who were in the synagogue were fixed upon him. And he began to say to them, "Today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." Now that's an amazing thing to say. He said to the Jews plainly, right up front, "I am the anointed one. I am the Messiah. And I will do miracles. I will display the power of the Holy Spirit." God the Father applied Psalm 2 to his son Jesus at his baptism when he said, "This is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased." Psalm 2, 7. That this Jesus is the Christ is the great point of apostolic testimony. Acts 17, 3. And this is the substance of our faith. For whosoever believeth that Jesus is the Christ, the Messiah, the anointed one, is born of God. 1 John 5, 1. And see 4 and 5. It is likewise the rock foundation in which he is building his church, Matthew 16, 18, and 1 Corinthians 3, 11. So one of the things you need to believe in order to be a Christian, one of the things that you need to believe in order to be saved is Jesus Christ, or Jesus of Nazareth, is the Christ. He is the Messiah. He is the anointed one. He's the one prophesied throughout the whole Old Testament to come. To be anointed beyond measure, to heal the sick, to give sight to the blind, to preach the gospel to the poor, to die on the cross as a sacrifice for sin and be resurrected and be enthroned as the glorious king. You got to believe that. And then second, in verse 25, the anointed one is called Messiah the Prince. Messiah the Prince. Now the term for prince here, Nigid means leader or ruler and could be applied to both religious and political leaders. Jesus is anointed by God as priest and king. He's also prophet too, but the focus in this passage is on his kingship and his priesthood. Because our Lord came to redeem his people and recreate the earth in righteousness, it was necessary that he bring in a salvific kingdom. A kingdom of grace, a kingdom of salvation, by offering himself on the cross. Now, he was definitely the king before his death on the cross. There's no question. But after his death and resurrection, he is the glorified king who has all power in heaven and on earth. And Jesus told his enemies, "You're going to see me come with power." The destruction of Jerusalem is the great apologetic to all Israel that Jesus was resurrected and his sacrifice was accepted. By the way, Matthew 28, 18 and following, and Romans 1, 4. It is interesting that the term prince is used often in the New Testament to describe Jesus. It's used way more than the term king, although king is used. In his Pentecost sermon, Jesus calls him the Prince of Life, Acts 3:15. The word used, only will recognize this word, archigos, indicates that he is not only in charge of all life, but he is the source of all life. In his second major sermon, Peter says, and this is Acts 5:31, him God has exalted to his right hand to be prince and savior, to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. Christ is in an exalted position and has authority over all as the Savior, as the priest king. The Jews wanted a military dictator to come and kill the Romans and the Greeks and the Persians. They completely misunderstood his ministry because they didn't understand Daniel and Jeremiah and Isaiah and the Psalms, etc., etc. He came to rule through his sacrificial death and resurrection. He's a priest king. In Revelation 1:5, we read, "Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler, archigos, prince, over the kings of the earth." So he is the prince because he is the firstborn from the dead. In Hebrews 2:10, we find a similar emphasis. For it was fitting for him, for whom are all things, and by whom are all things, Jesus Christ created everything, and he upholds every atom, every molecule, everything by his power, in bringing many sons to glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through sufferings. The word captain there is archigos, prince, leader, author, pioneer, lead climber, captain. He's the king through his suffering. He's the leader through his suffering and death. Jesus is the priest king, the source of life and salvation. And then Hebrews 12:2 reads, looking unto Jesus, the author, here's that word again, archigos, and finisher of our faith. So Christ as prince in Scripture indicates a unique salvific kingship. He provides the spiritual life necessary for a spiritual recreation by the efficacy of his death and resurrection. And thus is empowered to send the Holy Spirit, regenerate hearts, grant repentance and forgiveness of sins to his people. So his kingship is always connected in Scripture to his death on the cross. He is the prince or captain of salvation, and that as the heavenly high priest, he intercedes on our behalf and brings his people safely to home to heaven. Moreover, as the Savior King, he rules with love, compassion, and understanding, for he was tempted in all points like us, yet without sin. Hebrews 4:15. Remember Jesus teaching his apostles, I don't want you to be leaders like these Gentiles, like these pagans, who lord it over everybody and they're full of pride and like to boss people around. No, you're going to be a servant leader. Why? Jesus was a servant leader. He leads because he died for us. He leads as the Savior. So we can never divide the lordship of Christ from his being the Savior. We can never divide him being Savior from his lordship. They're connected. He's the priest king. He fought the fight. And he won the war. He secured and guaranteed a new creation. And this whole redemptive aspect of what it means for the Messiah to be prince was missing from the popular Jewish theology when Jesus came. They didn't see it at all. And it's amazing when you look at the detail of these prophecies in Jeremiah and Daniel and the Psalms. Now, interestingly, if you read Eidersheim and others, the ancient Jews interpreted these passages way better than modern Jews do, because once they rejected Christ and once the Christian church arose, they decided, hey, we got to get rid of all the messianic interpretations of these passages, and that's what they did. It's sad. For this reason, the Jews rejected him and were subjected to the judgment aspect of his rule instead of the salvific aspect. Christ rules. He's king. He's conquering by the sword that proceeds out of his mouth, the double-edged sword, the word of God. But if you don't submit to that sword, if you don't bow the knee to Christ, he's got the rod of iron. So there's a twofold aspect of his reign, and you better learn that twofold aspect, because you're either going to bow the knee to him as king and savior, or you're going to get the iron rod. And the United States, the way it's going right now, is heading for an iron rod. It's already begun. We've got the most wicked and incompetent leadership we've ever had as a nation, and that's part of the judgment. Jesus is the prince who conquers by the sharp sword that proceeds out of his mouth, Revelation 19:15. The inspired and infallible word of God. The gospel preached is necessary for the expanse of God's kingdom. The rod of iron is reserved for leaders and nations who refuse to bow before him. Now, when Obama goes over to Kenya and he spends a whole period of time rebuking them for having anti-homosexual laws and telling them that they need to accept fisting and sodomy, what do you think is going to happen in the United States? Wake up. And then third, the Messiah will be cut off. The verb here, kerot, is used of excommunication and the death penalty in the Old Testament, or capital punishment. Exodus 12, 15, 30, 33 and 38, Leviticus 7, 20. It is also the fate of all evildoers, according to Psalm 37, 2 and 9, indicating God's judgment against sin. He's going to receive a judicial execution for sin. Interestingly, the same verb is used of cutting a covenant, which was a bloody ritual, which involved the death of the sacrificial animal, the victim. Genesis 15, 10, and 18. The animals were literally cut in two. Isaiah says, 53, verse 8, the Messiah will be cut off from the land of the living. Jesus will be stricken. This is Isaiah 53, 14. Excuse me, 3 and 4. Jesus will be stricken, afflicted, wounded, bruised, chastised, and also be cut off and buried. Isaiah 53, 8 and 9. Even though he was perfectly innocent. Isaiah 53, 9. Isaiah 53, 12. He poured out his soul unto death. And Isaiah makes it explicitly clear. To bear the sin of his people. Substitutionary sacrifice. He died on the cross and suffered in our place so that we wouldn't have to, if you believe. Do you believe he's the Messiah? Do you believe he died on the cross for your sins? Do you believe he rose from the dead for your justification? If you do, you're saved. If you don't, you're going straight to hell. The Old Testament is very clear that Christ, the Messiah, the Anointed One, came to die a sacrificial death. Note Paul's testimony before the Jews. This is Acts 26 to 23. And as you know, they didn't receive this message well. They wanted to kill Paul. Therefore, having detained help from God, to this day I stand, witnessing both to small and great, saying no other things than these, which the prophets and Moses said would come. Did you catch that? Okay, you Jews, you unbelievers. Moses and the prophets, prophet said this was going to happen. Wake up. That the Christ would suffer. That he would be the first to rise from the dead. And would proclaim light to the Jewish people and to the Gentiles. And their response to that was they wanted to put him to death. And God put them to death. We see that this prophecy centers our attention upon the cutting off of Christ. With verse 24 in mind, the sacrificial death of the Messiah is clearly the main focus of the prophecy. You listen to these prophecy shows on the radio and they're all speculating. Is, you know, Kissinger the Antichrist? Is it Nixon? Is it Hitler? You know, and they have all these date setting and all this kooky stuff. That's not the focus of prophecy. The focus of prophecy is on the death of Christ and his ministry. And this feature becomes the more generally prominent when we take notice of the facts. Number one, that it was by the cutting off of the Messiah that the six predictive things of verse 24 were to be accomplished, which we looked at in detail last week. Number two, that it was the cutting off of the Messiah that the covenant with many, verse 27, was to be confirmed, and the sacrifice and oblation were caused to cease. And by the way, we'll look at that in a moment. The word there means that he took an existing covenant and he confirmed it. He made it efficacious. What does that do? That disproves the whole future Antichrist theory totally. We'll look at that in a moment. And three, that it was because of the cutting off of the Messiah that the devastating judgments foretold in the prophecy were to fall upon the city, the temple, and the people. Gabriel has told Daniel that the sacrificial death of Christ is the axis of all human history. It's the axis of all redemptive history. It's the most important thing in history. So Daniel prayed. And what's the centrality of the answer? Christ. Third, Jesus will confirm the covenant with his people. Now, this could be translated, he shall cause to prevail a covenant for the many, 1:7. Verse 27. He shall cause to prevail a covenant for the many, 1:7, or you could translate it confirm. As we analyze this statement, there are some important things to consider. Number one, this statement in verse 27 does not take place after the events of verse 26. Verse 26 and 27, and this is crucial to understanding this passage, it has an A-B-A-B structure. And both verses are focused on Christ's work and its consequences for Jerusalem. Once you understand this, the passage is much, much easier to understand. And any of you familiar with Hebrew literature, this is a characteristic of their poetry, their songs, and even their prophets, some of their prophecies. A. Pay attention. A. And after the 62 weeks, Messiah shall be cut off, but not for himself. That's 26a. Here's another A. This is from 27a. And he, Messiah, shall confirm a covenant with many for 1 week, but in the middle of the week he shall bring an end to sacrifice and offering. You see how they're teaching the same thing with slightly different emphasis? Now let's look at B. Verse 26b. And the people of the prince who is to come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. The end of it shall be with a flood. Till the end of the war, desolations are determined. Here's 27b. And on the wing of abominations shall be one who makes desolate, even until the consummation which is determined, which is poured out on the desolate. They're both teaching the same thing with a different emphasis. In verse 26, the Messiah comes after 62 weeks. It is only natural to take the middle of the week in verse 27 as the Messiah being cut off in the midst of the 70th week. This occurred circa AD 30, perhaps AD 29, when Jesus was excommunicated and crucified. If, as many Orthodox scholars argue, Jesus' baptism with the Holy Spirit beyond measure was the terminus point of the 62 weeks and the beginning of the 70th week, and I didn't go into detail about that because it would take a whole sermon to prove that, the prophecy fits perfectly. For after his baptism, our Lord's ministry lasted how long? 3.5 years. He was literally cut off in the middle of the week, just as the passage says. Thus, beginning and end, bringing an end to the sacrificial system in the middle of the week. It fits perfectly, folks. It fits perfectly. You don't have to talk about a future 10-nation confederacy and a future Antichrist and all that nonsense. With the A-B-A-B structure in mind, which was a Hebraistic way of speaking of the same things with a different emphasis, all theories of 2,000-year gap, of a 2,000-year gap, are rendered unnecessary and unexegetical. It's pure speculation. Since verse 26 declares that the Messiah is cut off or executed, verse 27 is teaching that the Messiah causes the covenant to prevail or to be confirmed by his ministry in death. And Hebrews speaks about that. The New Testament couldn't be established without the blood, the shedding of blood, and the death of the testator. The supposed 2,000-year gap completely destroys the A-B-A-B structure, which would have been understood by the Jews. Now, we read that, and we're Americans. We don't think in terms of these kind of structures. But to the Jew, they would have saw it instantly. They're repeating the same events with different emphasis. And then number two. Contrary to dispensational expositors, verse 27 does not say that a covenant is made, but that the Messiah makes the existing covenant efficacious. And that's crucial, because dispensationalists teach that the Antichrist, the leader of the 10-nation confederacy, is going to buddy up to the Jews and offer to protect them, and he's going to make a covenant with them. Then in the middle of the covenant, he's going to double-cross the Jews and start persecuting them, and he's actually going to set up a statue of himself in the temple. But that cannot be true. That is absolutely false. Because the Messiah makes the existing covenant efficacious. He confirms it. He causes it to be effective. Jesus, during his earthly ministry, obeyed the law in exhaustive detail, and he died on the cross to pay the penalty in full for the elect, the many, and thus fulfilled all the terms of the covenants given to Adam, the covenant of works, and Abraham, the covenant of grace. The promise to Abraham, which was continued in different administrations under Moses and David, etc. The promise is made to the fathers, Romans 15:8, was fulfilled in Jesus, the Messiah. The whole Old Testament flows and goes into him. He's the fulfillment. Now, Reformed theologians refer to the covenant with the fathers after the fall as the covenant of grace. And the Westminster Confession statement on this teaching is excellent. It's noteworthy. Man, by his fall, having made himself incapable of life by that covenant, and they're talking about the covenant of works, the Lord was pleased to make a second, commonly called the covenant of grace, whereby he freely offereth unto sinners life and salvation by Jesus Christ, requiring of them faith in him that they might be saved, and promising to give unto all them, all those that are ordained unto life, his Holy Spirit, to make them willing and able to believe. That's 7:3. This covenant is caused to prevail for the many. Dispensationalists completely ignore what the passage says. It's just mind-boggling. Thus a contrast is introduced between he and the many, a contrast which appears to reflect upon the great messianic passage, Isaiah 52:13 to 53:12, and particularly 53:11. He shall see the labor of his soul and be satisfied by his knowledge. My righteous servant shall justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Although the entire nation will not receive salvation, the many will receive it. The remnant, the elect, the sheep, his people will receive it. Fourth, the Messiah makes the existing covenant of grace efficacious, and this results in an end to the sacrifices and offerings. The moment that Jesus died, the veil of the temple was torn from the top all the way to the bottom. Matthew 27:51 and Mark 15:38. Right down the middle, Luke 23:45. The violent ripping of the inner curtain to the Holy of Holies means the covenant has been rendered efficacious, and all men now have access to heaven in the special presence of God by Christ and his precious blood. Hebrews 10:19-20. The veil symbolized that under the old covenant administration, the way to God was not yet open. See Hebrews 9:6-8. The sacrificing of the clean animals pointed to Christ, it pointed to the Messiah, but did not really put away sin or guilt. And we learn in Hebrews that they can't. You're not a goat, you're not a sheep. But the death of Christ is the actual, true, and only way to God the Father. John 14:6. The sacrifices of the temple were only shadows and types that pointed to the one and only real, true, and efficacious sacrifice, Jesus Christ's atoning death on the cross. The author of Hebrews makes this point perfectly clear. This is 7:11. Therefore, if perfection were made through the Levitical priesthood, what further need was there of another priest who should rise according to the order of Melchizedek and not be called according to the order of Aaron? Hebrews 8:13. And that he says, a new covenant, he has made the first obsolete. When? AD 29 or 30. And growing old, it is ready to vanish away. When did that occur? Well, it occurred actually the moment he died, but it definitely occurred in AD 70 when the temple was obliterated. And then Hebrews 9:23-28. Therefore, it was necessary that the copies of the things in heaven should be purified with these, but the heavenly things themselves with better sacrifices than these. For Christ has not entered the holy places made with hands, which are copies of the true, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us. Not that he should offer himself often, as the other priest enters the most holy place every year with blood of another. He then would have to suffer often since the foundation of the world. But now, once at the end of the ages, he has appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. And as it is appointed for men to die once, but after this the judgment, so Christ was offered once to bear the sins of many. To those who eagerly wait for him, he will appear a second time apart from sin for salvation. Now, Paul says explicitly that the old shadow ceremonial sacrifices were only copies or things that awaited their fulfillment in Christ. As Philip Edgecombe Hughes observes, quote, "There's a fundamental difference between the animal sacrifice in the Levitical system and the unique sacrifice by Christ himself in the priestly order of Melchizedek. Animals are not moral creatures. The unblemished condition of those victims offered up was merely external and superficial in character for the purposes of ritual symbolism. Neither by nature nor in any moral sense were they fitted to take the place of man, who is answerable for his conduct and morally defiled in his conscience at the deep center of his being. By contrast, Christ, the incarnate Son, is a fellow human being, partaking of our own human nature," Hebrews 2:14, "and therefore as man fully qualified to stand in for us as our substitute and as one without blemish, that is, as a man morally perfect with an undefiled conscience before God," Hebrews 4:15 and 7:27, "competent to offer up the completely efficacious sacrifice of his own unblemished person in the satisfaction for our sins and for the purifying of our consciences. It is not merely superficial, but in the very depth of his being, that our Redeemer is without blemish, and thus that his sacrifice of himself deals in a radical manner with the alienating and disintegrating effects of human sinfulness," end of quote. The main thing that the Bible taught the Jews didn't get, the cutting off of the Messiah. They didn't get it. And they had no reason not to get it, because the Bible taught it clearly in the Old Testament and repeatedly in the Old Testament. Here's another one, Hebrews 10, 8 to 14. "Previously saying, sacrifice and offering, burnt offerings, burnt offerings and offerings for sin you did not desire, nor had pleasure in them which are offered according to the law. But then he said, behold, I have come to do your will, O God." That's the Messiah. "He takes away the first, that he may establish the second. By that will we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus once for all. And every priest stands ministering daily and offering repeatedly the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But this man, after he offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down at the right hand of God, that from that time, waiting till his enemies are made his footstool. For by one offering he has perfected forever those who are being sanctified." Could the Bible be any clearer than that? Although it is true that for around 40 years the Jews continued to offer sacrifices at the temple, these post-crucifixion sacrifices were signs of unbelief and were rebellion against Christ and were not accepted. And in years ago we did a study on the death of Christ, and the moment Christ died and the temple was, the veil was ripped in two, there's a prophecy that talks about how the presence of God left the temple at that moment. The temple was no longer God's special house. "To place one's trust in an access to God not built on Jesus, who came and proved himself to be the Messiah with many signs and his own resurrection, is not only futile and ineffectual, but also sinful." It essentially says that Christ is not the only way of entering everlasting life. It says that the blood of the Redeemer is unnecessary and rejects the perfection and efficacy of Jesus' sacrifice. We must keep in mind that the moment Jesus died, Once he was put to death, the temple no longer was God's special house, and Jerusalem ceased to be the holy city. That's all gone the moment he died. God placed the unbelieving Jews along with their temple and city under judgment. And the actual cessation of sacrifices and the demolition and burning of the temple took place under Titus in AD 70 was a direct result of the rejection and murder of Christ 40 years earlier. Once again, I call to mind the ABAB structure. When you focus on the ABAB structure, the passage becomes crystal clear. The one led automatically to the other. It is for this reason that the ABAB structure in our passage, the destruction of Jerusalem, is the two B events. A, Christ dies. A, Christ removes sin. A, Christ is cut off. Not for himself, but for his people, for the many. B, the sacrifices cease. B, Jerusalem is destroyed. When Jesus died, the old order died with him. Israel was replaced by the International New Covenant Church. The Messiah, by his death, did abrogate and put an end to the whole sacrificial system forever and set in motion the execution of his wrath upon Jerusalem. And remember, this is a super important thing in the New Testament. You've got it in Matthew 23 and 24. You've got it in Luke 21. You've got it in Mark 13. The old order ended with the death of Christ. And then to make sure it ended, Christ obliterated Jerusalem. And I'll read in a moment. We'll take a break. I'll read in a moment how one historian, an ancient historian, he looked at the city after the destruction. He says, it's hard to believe anybody actually lived there. It was so destroyed. Here's what J.C. Ryle says. Jerusalem and the temple were the heart of the old Jewish dispensation. When they were destroyed, the Old Testament system came to an end. The daily sacrifice, the yearly feast, the altar, the Holy of Holies. And we could add choirs and musical instruments and incense. And the priesthood were all essential parts of revealed religion until Christ came, but no longer. When he died upon the cross, their work was done. They were dead. And it only remained that they should be buried. But it was not fitting that this should be done quietly. The ending of a dispensation given to so much solemnity at Mount Sinai might well be expected to be marked with particular solemnity. The destruction of the Holy Temple, which so many old saints had seen, where so many old saints had seen shadow of good things to come, might be well be expected to form a subject of prophecy. And so it was. The Lord Jesus specifically predicts the desolation of the holy place, verse 15. The great high priest describes the end of the dispensation which had been put in charge to lead people to himself. That's from his commentary on Matthew. That's from his study of Matthew 24. So the dispensational idea that this all refers to a future Roman dictator, European dictator, who will double cross the Jews and stop their sacrifices in a rebuilt third or fourth temple, depending on how you count it, is unbiblical and it's ludicrous. It's absurd, and it takes our mind off of Christ and puts it on a supposed future Antichrist. Instead of focusing our attention on Christ and his work, which is the whole design of our passage, it focuses our attention on a future Antichrist. And it's sad because, you know, you watch these prophecy shows, you listen to these radio shows, and you could listen to them for years and years and years and not ever hear the gospel. Instead of focusing our attention on the work of Jesus for his church, it singles out the Jews and treats them as more special than the church, which is a serious error. For the kingdom was transferred from national Israel to the New Covenant International Church, which included Jews. Now we're going to take a little break. We're going to come back. There's more. It's an amazing passage. I hope you're seeing how great it is. And keep in mind that ABAB structure. Once you look at these two verses with the ABAB structure, they become very clear. For they're saying essentially the same thing with different emphasis. Let's pray. Father, we just give you thanks, Lord, for this amazing prophecy that points us to your dear Son, Jesus Christ. We pray, Lord, that any people who hear this, who are not saved, would see the beauty of your Son, Jesus Christ, and believe in him as the Messiah, the Son of God, who takes away the sin of the world, who looks to his sacrifice as the only way to remove sin. We exalt your Son, Jesus Christ, as Scripture exalts him. And we thank you for sending him. For our sins, in Jesus' name, amen.